Hello everyone. Today's video is super special to me. Not just because I made something cool and I get to show it off after months of dedicating my free time to it. Not just because I solved a problem that's been annoying me for years. Not just because it taught me that you're never too old to learn something new. But mostly because I get to give something back. I literally made a thing that I don't really need, but I oh so strongly wish I had myself a few years ago. So today, I'm making it freely available, completely open source, for anyone to make, have made, buy, copy, or clone without any strings attached. It came to be because a few years ago, I unintentionally ordered some cheap read-only memory chips that I thought I could easily program with what I wanted, but eventually found out I couldn't. It turned out the easiest way was to buy a $70 programmer for my $1 chips, and suddenly my hobby needed a bigger financial commitment than I was happy with at the time. Back then, I didn't have the skills to make a cheaper one myself, so I did what so many hobbyists do and bought the expensive programmer. But now, I am happy to announce that if you feel the same way I did about the price of ROM programmers, today is your lucky day. This is the relatively universal ROM programmer shield, and it'll burn almost any ROM you can imagine, no matter if it's a modern 5-volt flash ROM or an ancient UV erasable ROM that needs over 20 volts to burn. It doesn't have all the extra features an expensive programmer does, like flashing microcontrollers or testing logic ICs, but it does what it's supposed to and does it for less than $10. And if you don't want to solder all the SMD components yourself, I can even sell you a kit for that price. More on that later in the video. Because, like I have a habit of doing, I'm getting a bit ahead of myself. If you're new to the channel, I already made 5 videos on getting to a working programmer on a breadboard, and if you have a breadboard and a lot of time, that's certainly a cheap way to build this programmer. But thanks to the sponsor of this video, you don't have to. If you somehow haven't heard of JLC PCB, they're a major PCB manufacturer that also offer PCB assembly, 3D printing services, CNC machining, and mechatronic parts, all at super reasonable prices. If you're new to JLC PCB and sign up using the link in the description, you also get a bunch of new customer coupons. I've used them for both hobby and professional projects for years, and I've always been happy with their service. I ordered the boards with all the SMD components pre-assembled, and since I made all the files available, you can do the same by simply uploading the Gerber files, BOM, and placement file from GitHub and just checking the parts from the BOM and placements are correct. After ordering, the board showed up after just 8 days, which is crazy considering FedEx had the package for 6 of those days. On a first run like this, I'm always worried I messed something up that makes the whole thing into electronics waste on day one, but hopefully nothing is completely broken. Besides the assembled boards, I also got a few blank PCBs. It's always good to have a physical board to test things if something is wrong or you need to make adjustments for the next revision. No time to worry about those though, as I can't wait to see the actual boards. It looks like they're stuck back to back with capped on tape and the component side covered with foam. And I think that's plenty even if the bubble wrap slides around in the box. Now let's take a look at the board. It looks like all components are in the right orientation and with the right side up. And I gotta say, it's prettier than I expected. It's hard to see on camera, but even though I went a bit smaller than JLC's listed capabilities, this silkscreen text looks 100% spot on. I'm not going to put it under a microscope, but it's certainly much better than I was promised. Now, to quickly solder this, so we can give it a test, I like to break the male headers into pieces of the right length and insert them into the Arduino footprint we're targeting. That way, we know it fits perfectly when it's soldered without too much fuss. Of course, I always end up breaking the headers at the wrong spot, but at least we can still put them in the right spot anyway. Soldering the 65 Arduino underneath this was super easy, so I don't even know what to call this. Even under the camera, it's almost a pleasure. Usually, I would at least test if power nets are shorted with a multimeter before plugging in power, but I really can't wait any longer, so here goes. I think I saw a blink when I plugged it in, and now I just see a faint red LED for the voltage regulator, just like we would expect. Since we have the output enable pin set high by default, I guess the LED for that lights up because it's powered through the shot key on the pin. Since the 6532 on the 65 Arduino pulls both its ports high during reset, we should be able to see everything light up by pressing reset. And they're all red. That is actually not intentional. And of course, there's no amount of times I can press the reset button to make them green like I intended. I was pretty sure I fixed that in the BOM, but I guess I forgot to do that when I finally ordered the boards. Whoops. Now that the board shows some signs of life, I guess we better configure and calibrate it. But of course, there's no functional difference, so I can live with the red color, considering it also means all three register ICs at the bottom work as intended. Probably. I'm not sure a normal Arduino Uno would work the same way, as it probably tri-states all the pins during reset, but this does mean that for my combination here, there shouldn't be anything in the socket during reset, as it might get damaged since the programming voltages are all enabled when all the pins are pulled high. Depending on the number of pins the ROM you want to program has, there are some jumpers defined on the board. If you know you're only ever going to be programming 28-pin ROMs, you can just put two solder blobs for the 28-pin configuration. But since I'll probably be trying almost anything with this first board, I'll solder in headers to use with actual jumpers. I already went through the complete walkthrough of the jumper configuration in the last video, so if you have a board in hand, you might want to check that out too. To make sure the jumper headers don't point in the opposite directions, I put them into a two-row socket I have randomly on my desk and use a little mini breadboard to hold it while soldering, and trying my best to keep it level. Since I don't have an onboard UART on this board, I also solder the RX, TX, and ground header on there so we can upload code to the 65 Arduino underneath, and hopefully binary data for the ROM when the software is ready. To make that somewhat vertical too, I use the good old trick of soldering a single pin and checking before soldering the rest. And since the iron's already hot, I might as well solder on the OLED display header. And to get ready for a 28-pin ROM, I install the jumpers to connect BCC and A13. Now, if we plug it back in, we should actually be able to use the screen and upload code. To test if the registers behave exactly like we expect, I wrote this little piece of code to test it out. All it does is rotate a bit and save it to all the registers. It's a lot dimmer on camera than in real life, but if I turn off my lights here, you should be able to see it's actually doing what it's supposed to. Perfect. Now, before we throw a chip at it, we better make sure the programming voltage is somewhere around what we need. So I also made a little snippet of code just to activate the regulator. For the Winbond W27C512s that I plan to program the most of, the regulator voltage needs to be 14 volts. This is one of the things the expensive programmer gets around by having a few preset voltages to choose from. And the TL866 I have doesn't go over 18 volts. But for this, I decided to leave it completely analog, so you can set it to whatever you want with, within reason, up to 22 volts by default and up to about 27 volts with a hardware mod. The voltage from the factory might vary a bit, and mine here is set to a bit over 16 volts, which might be a bit much for the Winbonds. So let's see if we can get it down to 14. You have to be super careful with these trimmers since they break easily if you try to turn it too far. Trust me, I know from experience with adjusting stepper motor drivers. If you put this shield on a board with an analog to digital converter on board, like an Arduino Uno instead of my 6502 based retro board here, it's pretty easy to skip the multimeter. A sharp commenter on the last video pointed out that if you have a spare analog pin, you can just measure the voltage with a voltage divider, and I did think about that, but not enough to actually connect a voltage divider to the pin. I did make the connection easily available though, so in a future video I'll certainly show how to do that with a little bodge. Now of course it looks like we might be missing something in the middle here. I guess technically we could just solder in a ROM, but that might be a mess when we need to put it somewhere else. In a pinch, I guess we could just hold a ROM on the footprint with a finger, but you've probably already guessed where this is going. We need a socket to hold the ROM. Since this is a budget programmer, an easy and super cheap way to get going is to put in a normal DIP socket with square holes, and if you only need 28 pins, you'd install it like this. But of course, there's nothing to lose by just installing a 32-pin socket just in case, and you can still use smaller ROMs if you just insert them to the right. If I only planned to program a single ROM once in a while, I'd probably go with the 32-pin socket, as it's cheap and not impossible to replace if it breaks. But as you might have noticed, there's a lot of empty PCB space around the socket. And that's because it's designed for a 28 or 32 pin zero insertion force or SIF socket, which makes it super easy to insert and remove ROMs without tools and lasts quite a bit longer than a simple DIP socket would. There are some really expensive models out there, but generally you can get one for a few bucks and up. The downside to this particular one is that the pins just barely fit into the footprint I used for the shield. The trick to getting it right is to make sure all the pins are pulled as far down as they'll go and locking it before trying to push it through the holes. If it's unlocked or all the pins aren't all the way down, some pins might get pushed up and have a hard time making connection with the pins of the ROM. I have to fight a bit more than usual to get all the pins aligned and into the through holes, but it looks like I'm getting there and we're finally ready to solder the last part. Looks good. So if we just plug in the UART and power, we should be ready to program a ROM. This is so exciting. I think this might actually work. There's some noise on the UART when I insert the ROM, which isn't so weird considering it's sharing the pins, but hopefully we can just send the code to clone the ROM. I'll reset it first to reduce the risk of bugs. And it worked! And you can actually see the last address it wrote on the LEDs. 0FFF is lit up and it only took a second. This is amazing. Just for the fun of it, I'll burn the ROM again and it just keeps working. So much could have gone wrong, but except for the unintentional red LEDs, we actually have a working board without a single bodge. I don't have a lot of these shields, but those I have left, I'm putting on my webshop with a link in the description. Excluding headers, VAT, and socket, I can sell it for $9 US or about €8.50. If you also like 6502 computers, I'm sure you'll also love the 6502ino that I use to control the programmer shield. I still have a few kits and ICs left on my shop too. Prices on my shop are listed including VAT, but if you order from outside the EU, the VAT is deducted at checkout. I can ship to 51 different countries globally pretty cheaply, but if you don't live in one of those, I'm sure JLC PCB can make you a board and ship it to you. I've put the files and instructions on the GitHub for this project, links for everything in the description, of course. Now that we have a working programmer, you might have noticed there's an elephant in the room. how do you actually put a binary file on the ROM from a computer? What code do you put on a normal Arduino or other development board? Which ROMs does it specifically support, and how do you configure a new one? Those are all questions that we can hopefully answer in software, some of which I plan on showing off in future videos. I plan on making the basic library available for my 6502ino in 6502 assembly, and also an Arduino sketch, so it's easy to get working with as many ROMs as possible. If you'd like to help with the software, feel free to submit a pull request on GitHub, and if you've made it this far into the video, I'm sure you will fit right in over on my Clubhouse on Discord. So please come say hi, there's a link in the description. Finally, a big thanks to everyone who supported the making of this video by buying a 6502ino kit from my shop, by becoming a channel member, and to JLCPCB for sponsoring the video. Making things that other people enjoy too is such a good motivation to keep making these videos. So thank you all so much. Either way, thanks for watching.